So who do we have on the podcast today, Rick?
We had a good pal of ours, Samir. So Samir is from Gents Talk. I was on his podcast maybe about a month ago or so, and he has one of, arguably probably one of the biggest Canadian-based podcasts out there, and he talks about men's mental health, like kind of promoting performative masculinity.
No, not.
Non-performative masculinity, which is healthy masculinity. That's what he's trying to promote. And just really being in tune with yourself as men and trying to just change the narrative for young men. His podcast is amazing.
Positive masculinity.
Positive masculinity. He's a great speaker, great guest. He's an even better host. Like when I was on his, he was, he's honestly just a great fucking person.
Yeah, I was actually like before coming into it, obviously like knew about his podcast and it's very obviously male focused. So I was kind of wondering where this conversation was going to go and like how I could speak on this too. But I had a lot of fun talking to him and I think it was a really good episode.
Yeah, it's a conversation that I just like generally, like I was listening, he was talking and I was like, oh, like he said something and I was like, yeah, well, that'd be nice if we could normalize that. And then 2 seconds later he said it. I was like, fuck, everything he's saying, I'm just thinking.
Yeah, I think it's a conversation that more people need to have.
Yeah. And if you are struggling with like mental health, obviously like speak to your friends about it. Go do the, take the steps you need to get the help.
Speak to anyone about it. Not even just your friends. Speak to someone. Someone's there. Someone will be there to listen.
Yeah. And if you like need guidance, need tools, like his podcast is fucking amazing. He's had so many great guests from Russell Peters, John Osorio, Donovan Bailey, James Blunt, Iggy Alberts. What's his name? Anyways, he's had so many amazing artists on and so many amazing guests. And his podcast is on Air Canada too. Again, it's called Gents Talk. Samir, you're an amazing guest. You're an amazing host, amazing fucking person. And I'm glad we've become pals now. And I know I'm going to be seeing you around. So I don't know, Danny, anything else?
No, I think that's it.
I feel like Let's Fucking Go would sound weird in this episode.
It would.
Let's fucking
go.
Last week? Didn't we record last week with a guest?
Nope.
Oh, no, yeah, someone canceled last
week. Two people canceled.
Yeah, we had two episodes canceled. Bastards. It's nice to have another podcaster on, though. Like, someone who knows, like, who gets it. Like, and yours is obviously, like, way more legit than ours. Like, it's
different.
And more legit. Like, you're on... I see so many people share Air Canada, like, how yours is on Air Canada, and I'm just like, that's arguably, like, the coolest thing to
it.
Like, your podcast is on Air Canada, like... There's only like 10 podcasts on Air Canada too. Yours is one of them. I'm like, that's fucking cool.
I thought it was a scam. When they reached out, I was like, don't call me. I'm not giving you my SIN number. I'm not sending money to some Nigerian princess. Like, I'm not doing the thing. And then they called back and they're like, no, this is legit. Can can we talk about how to get the podcast on board? And I thought, okay. And I come to our office. Their office is actually right by the Eaton Center. Go into the office, have my laptop, a deck ready, the whole works ready to present. And before I can start, they go, so what do we have to do to convince you to let us put this on board?
So they wanted to pitch you.
Yeah. And at this point, I'm only 8 episodes into the podcast. Like, we've only released 8 ever. And they had seen number 8, binged the first 7, and then the next day reached out and said, we want this on our flights. And I was like, okay. And that was in September of 2022, January 2023. And I had to sit on this information for like 3 months. Like, I couldn't tell anybody. January 2023, we're on board Air Canada, and we've just been stacking episodes since. And we just signed a licensing agreement with the content provider to hopefully be onboarded onto like 10 or 15 more airliners. So
that's so cool.
It's exciting. It's so much work. I mean, you understand this. There's there's so much that goes into a podcast that's not just this part is easy.
Was it you I was just talking about that with? What? Or is it someone else? Like, the recording is the easiest part about podcasting. No. Like, by a mile. Never mind the scheduling guests, making sure guests show up, because everybody, like, when you texted me yesterday, we still on for tomorrow, I was just like, I usually do morning of.
Mm.
And when you text me, I'm just like, it's so nice that you're another podcaster because you get it. Like, yeah. People bailed on you too. I'm 100%. Yeah. Oh, like, that was tomorrow? It's like, yeah, there's a Google Calendar invite with all the, like, everything. You accepted it. It's in your calendar.
Like, yeah, and the number of times I've been asked, like, what's the address? What's all the information? What do I need to provide you? And I'm like, we literally had this conversation.
Yeah, it's like, it's all in the email.
What's been your, like, biggest learning experience, though, with the podcast and, like, kind of, like, the back end?
On the back end, it's a pain in the ass.
We get it.
It's not that enjoyable, but...
Or, like, your biggest fuck-up.
Oh, biggest fuck-up is different.
Yeah, that one is... What's my biggest fuck-up? I had to film an episode with someone that I couldn't publish. And I had to go back to their agent and say, I'm not publishing this. And it was an uncomfortable conversation because they... We're not happy with it, but I was actually protecting the talent because the episode was so bad. The person said three words in every answer, and there was just silence is okay on a podcast, but long silences are that's very uncomfortable, and the person just would not really give good answers. And that also had something to do with the fact that he was particularly young and just coming into his own and sort of building out his career. But I think my biggest lesson from that, actually to your earlier question, a lot more vetting. Like, unless you've done some sort of public speaking that I can see, and or if, unless we have, like, similar to ours, we had a conversation, even it's like 15 minutes, like, hey, how's your morning? I'm not having you on the pod.
See, it's so funny, and I completely get what you're saying, because we've had artists, musicians specifically, and even other people, where they're so good at public speaking, they're great in person, and they come on and they kind of suck. And we haven't had many. We've only had like a handful maybe, where it's just, I know the story you're telling. I remember seeing it on like social media, and it looked amazing, and you were just like, yeah, well, it was cool. It was cool? Bro, you did X, Y, and Z. Like, it was the craziest trip ever. And you're going to tell me it was cool?
But I can also, that's the answer? I think there's like two parts to that, because I also feel like some people that we've had on, you can talk to them off air and you can think they're like great guests, or they've told the story before with so much enthusiasm, and then they come on the podcast and maybe they're just having a bad day.
Yeah.
Like, they're just having a bad hour.
Yeah.
And it's unfortunate, but like, it happens.
There's also the other side too, where you have someone that you're not sure if they're going to be great, and they come on and they flip a switch, yeah, and they're just like,
those are my favorite.
So
ours, where was this earlier?
Yeah, we don't kind of vet anybody. We think, okay, you're doing something cool, or I see you're doing something cool, or you know what? Like, we've had people on where I liked your social media post. I thought that was a good post. I want to get you on.
Mm.
Because I'm like, if that post is cool, maybe there's more to you that's, you're doing cool shit.
Yeah.
And sometimes we've had ones where you're kind of not excited. You're just like, okay, we're doing this because it's a job. It's a hobby now. And they come in and just rock your world. And
you're like, even like when PR companies like reach out, and they're like reaching out with the same person like five times. They're like, okay, you know what? Let's just do it. We're both ready to like, not in the mood. And it ends up being one of the best episodes.
Yeah.
Yeah. That I love when that happens, because you've kind of set the bar so low yourself, and then they come in and they just smash it out of the park. You're like, holy shit, that was a really good episode. Like, I really got,
yeah,
like, you know, what was that? How do I capture that and do it again and again?
Have you ever had an episode where you feel that you didn't do well?
Oh, all the time.
Really?
Yeah.
I feel you're a great host though.
Thank you.
You are very good.
I appreciate you saying that.
You're very well spoken.
Today I filmed an episode, literally right before this.
Oh, so it's nice. And you're like, you're in the groove right now. You're chilling now.
Well, so I filmed an episode right before this, like an hour ago. And prior to that, I was a guest on another podcast. So
you're,
I'm like,
killing it today.
I've been doing a lot of talking today. So I'm like either really amped up, or I'm going to like crash halfway through. We're going to find out. But because I had done that first one, three is like my max. When I do a third, I'm exhausted. And I've done a couple of those where I filmed three in a day where I'm the host. Different when you're the guest, because you can relax a little bit. But when you're the host, you're constantly attentive. You're alert.
And you got to guide the conversation.
Exactly. And so I had done three one day, and I was just, by the third one, I might have been dozing off, like unintentionally, just like looking at the clock, like, all right, how many more questions do I have to ask to get us to this time? And again, it's not that the guest wasn't interesting. It was just that I was burnt out.
And you're mentally drained.
Oh, yeah. People don't understand. Talking, it's well, hard.
Well, like after two podcasts, like, I'm done. Like, I think two is hard.
In general.
Ours is two. We won't do more than a double recording a day.
And that's stopped, very rare that we'll do one. Like, I'm pretty sure we're supposed to have one today.
Yeah, but we'll only do it if we know, we know the guests.
Yeah.
Because then it's like, it's a lot easier to guide the conversation. And because ours isn't an interview, it's not like there's preset questions and, you know, we've got, okay, you got this one, I got this one, you got that. Like, it's like, no, wherever the conversation takes us, we're going. Yeah. So it's like, you have to be attentive and alert of the entire episode or else you're going to get to that awkwardness where we get quiet and we suck. And if we do, then the guest is kind of like, what the fuck? Like, yeah. You guys suck.
And that's why I tend to ask a lot of open-ended questions, because it's like I want to do as little talking as the host as possible. It's not about me, it's about you. When you come and sit down in that chair across from me, I want to know about you, your persona, your psyche. I'll insert 2 cents every so often, like a story, a personal anecdote, but outside of that, you're doing all the talking. And that's something I found, like, that's a strategy that I found works for me, because it allows me to sort of sit back and also just curiously learn.
Well, that's the best part about like what we do as podcasters. You learn so much about so many different people from so many different walks of life. Like, I don't think we've ever had, even the guests we've had on more than once, like, they're almost different episodes every time.
Yeah, for
like,
sure.
I think Johnny Orlando, I think Kia, I think Ollie, I think, who else have we had that was a double guest or a triple guest? But every episode's different every time they come on. And it's never the same conversation. Yeah. So you're always like...
Well, I feel like it's a lot of the times too, you're getting to know someone, or like we're trying to get our guests to know someone. The second time it's like, what else about you can we share?
How much deeper can we dig?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a natural curiosity. And I joke and I tell people this all the time. I'm like, the podcast is just a manifestation of my own curiosity. I'm just literally going,
that's nice.
What am I curious about this week or next week? What topic am I interested in? Let's find a guest that fits that. And that's how I bring in certain experts. I'm like, I want to, you know, I had a conversation with a buddy of mine whose wife is about to give birth in a month. I'd like to learn more about parenting because one day I want to be a father. So I literally search up, find people, bring them in, start asking them questions that I would want to know about, and then go from there.
Do you think you learn a lot about yourself by like having these different guests on?
Yeah, because a lot of times it turns into almost a therapy session for me, where they're like asking me questions about my life and I'll answer them and they'll be like, oh, well, did you know that by answering this way, you're actually doing this? And I go, oh, I didn't actually realize that.
My man started a podcast just so he gets free therapy. Yeah, exactly. Right? Yeah. Work didn't cover. Work's only got $500. Ah, don't worry. I got this.
It's on me. I haven't paid for therapy in 2 years.
Hey, no, why did you start it?
And for
those who don't know, give us like a brief rundown on Gents Talk.
Yeah. So maybe I'll do like it's funny. I tested out this bio this morning. So I'm going to test it out again and you guys can let me know if it works. I always struggle with how I introduce myself because I never know whether to introduce myself by the various hats I wear. So I've changed it up and I now introduce myself as Samir, a man who believes in empowering other men to live a healthier life, right? Positive masculinity. I do that through work on things like the podcast, Gents Talk. So during the pandemic, my business partner reached out and said, you know, starting a men's lifestyle publication, calling it Gents Post. Gents, short form for gentlemen. The idea was to redefine what modern masculinity looks like. Let's not just talk about what LeBron James wore to the game last night. Let's talk about the fact that LeBron James has a mental coach, a performance coach. Let's talk about the fact that most men are secretly searching up how to deal with confidence, how to deal with, you know, if they're balding, how to deal with skincare problems, how to deal with relationship problems, but they don't talk about it. So why don't we be the ones to talk about it and normalize it? About a year later, an agency reached out and said, hey, Samir, Russell Peters is coming to Toronto. Would you want to interview him? And I said, yeah, absolutely. It's Russell Peters. Are you kidding me? I'm like trying to contain my smile through the phone. Hung up and immediately thought, okay, I've always loved podcasts just as a listener. And I'd ideated on finally having my own. And if there was ever a moment to launch a podcast, you're doing it with Russell Peters. So I'm like, let me just take a shot in the dark here. I called them literally right back and said, can I get Russell on video? I didn't say podcast. I just said video. And they go, yeah, sure. I was like, oh, okay. I'm like, where's your studio? I'm like, where's he going to be? And they're like, well, we'll get you the hotel details.
They where's he?
Yeah.
Where's your studio? Where are you going to be?
Yeah, exactly. They told me he was at some hotel in downtown Toronto, somewhere on University or something like that. And I'm like, great. I'll be right back. Literally searched up a studio, found, I think it's called the Staples Studio. Reached out to them and said, hey, I got Russell Peters coming into town. Can I film in your space? They're like, yeah, absolutely. I'm like, and I don't want to pay for it. And they're like, of course, it's Russell. We just want him in the space. I'm like, great. Hired a videographer, never worked with him before. Don't know the first thing about podcasting. I'm like searching up, how do you even start a podcast? Like, what do you got to do? Relying on a random videographer I met on Fiverr to like, can you help me out here? You based in Toronto? Great. So the day shows up. We set up. 2 hours go by. Russell's not there. The studio guy, the guy in charge, comes over and he goes, so like, is he coming? And you could tell like he was a fan. He's getting excited to see Russell. Super nice guy, by the way. And I'm like, you know, I hope he's coming. Like, it's just...
it's gonna be awkward.
Yeah, it's like four people in a room just standing there with camera, lights, and everything, just sitting there for 2 hours.
Like, you don't know everyone there either. Like, no. You're like, you hired these people.
Yeah, like, this could all fail. Like, this could all fail miserably. I get a text 2 minutes out. I'm like, all right, everybody, let's go. We go, we stand outside to do, like, the greeting. He comes out of his car there. Comes up, shakes my hand on the curb. We walk in and I'm just like, holy fuck, act cool, Samir, act cool. He comes in, he sits down, he goes, so what's this about? Like, they hadn't even shared anything with him. I was like, okay, well, we're...
I can picture him being like that too. So what are we doing today? What are we talking about?
Oh, you have to see, I'll send you the clip afterwards. He actually makes fun of me in the episode. And I was like, trying not to laugh and take it seriously. And I didn't know the difference between the two yet. So he sits down and he goes, what's this about? And I go, only thing I could blurt out was, we're redefining masculinity. And I'm just staring at him. He leans back and he goes, what the hell does that mean? And I'm like, oh, well, we're basically trying to just help men become better men, you know, by talking about things that matter. And he goes, okay. And he looks around to the people that brought him into the room, because again, we're like very different from all the other media stops he'd probably done. 10 minutes into the conversation, he goes, you know, Samir, the pandemic was the darkest days of my life. Him and his ex had just split up. He had lost access to see his son. And there is a generational comedian sitting inside a 12,000 square foot mansion, house, cars, money, fame, and none of it mattered because he couldn't see the one person that did. And that was lightning in a bottle for the podcast. And I knew in that moment, this is our why. And this is why we need to do more of them. And then we had Jonathan Osorio come in for episode number 2. And we're like, holy crap, we have a Toronto FC player going to the World Cup. And he talked about how no matter how well he had played, he couldn't get everyone to love him. And he struggled with that. He was like, I'd score goals. I'd do everything right. And I'd still get criticized online. And I just didn't know what to do about it. And again, it just kept adding. And suddenly we got to a point where people were reaching out to us saying, hey, we saw the episode. We would love to have so-and-so come and talk. Because it's an opportunity for them to finally talk in a way where they've never really been able to talk before. Because most talent come through the city. They get asked a million times what their favorite restaurant is, where they like to hang out. And no one ever asks them, you know, like, how was your morning?
How you doing?
James Blunt turned to me and said, in all his years, a Grammy-winning artist, in all my years doing interviews globally with some of the biggest organizations on the planet, never once has he been able to do an interview as James the man and not James Blunt the artist. And I was just like, could we get that on camera, anyone? But it's just this, it reinforces this idea that I think men are just looking for an outlet. They're looking for the permission to talk. And they just need that little nudge, that encouragement to do so. And if I can showcase what we would consider to be successful men having these conversations, maybe the young men that look up to these guys will look at that and go, okay, maybe I can have these conversations. Maybe it is okay for me to say I'm not okay.
That was such a funny start to the conversation. And then the the 180 after that, the comment about Russell Peters, I was like, fuck, man. Like, and that's also great that your first episode was Russell Peters.
Yeah.
Like, we've had Oso on two or three times now, I think. And, like, he's become a friend, which is, like, awesome. Like, love Oso. Yeah. And, again, going to the World Cup, he's a TFC legend. Like, yeah. He'll be, his jersey will be hung in the TFC rafters when he's finally done. But, again, like, when you get something like that for yours, like, you can't get a better comment than that.
Yeah. It's humbling. For a long time, I had been searching for something meaningful to do, right?
So I know you said that, like, so your business partner reached out to you saying he was going to do the blog post. What made, like, you want to kind of go into this, like, niche podcast space? Like, of you, with you talking about it. Like, I know you got, like, the reached out by, like, Russell Peters, but, like, what was, like, you're, like, this is where, like, I need to...
My why?
Yeah.
So... For a long time prior to all of this, prior to the pandemic, I was a project manager. I had a great job, great pay. I was checking off all the right boxes. Got married, traveled the world, checking off more boxes, doing all the things that I had been told a guy is supposed to do. And then suddenly it just wasn't leaving me feeling very content anymore. And there was something that was not fitting right. The pieces just didn't fit together. It was like you trying to put together a puzzle, except you're using pieces from a different puzzle. Just, it didn't work. But I didn't have the toolbox to articulate any of that. I didn't know how to say, hey, there's something wrong and I don't know how to say any of this. And to make matters worse, I didn't know how to confide in the people who were in my life, right? Again, I was married. I didn't even know how to say the words, hey, I need help, to the person who's supposed to be the closest to me. And that basically started this downward trajectory of not feeling content, probably falling into some sort of depression. I know we talked about this on the podcast. It's like there's just something wrong and I can't put words on it. I didn't want to get out of bed. I didn't want to do anything. I was not motivated to do anything, go anywhere, see anyone. And then the relationship faltered. All my relationships faltered. I stopped watering them. I thought for a long time as a guy, I only had to work as hard to get to the altar. And then once that's over, I'm done. I put in the work. I don't need to do more. I'm married. Like, what else do I need to do? And so the relationship faltered. I didn't show up the way I was supposed to as a husband, as a friend, as a partner. And in some respects, she didn't show up the way she should have as well. But ultimately, I can only speak for the way I didn't show up. And when... one morning she just decided, you know what, I'm done, I'm out. What did I do? I didn't deal with it. I just buried further, because that's what we've been told, right? Just man up, be quiet, you don't talk about emotions, those don't exist for your kind. And it worked for like 3 weeks until the pandemic happened, the black swan event that changed the entire course of the world. No sports on TV. No bars, no clubs, no restaurants, no friends, no gym. So even your good outlets and your bad outlets were all wiped away. And there I am sitting inside of a condo thinking, I got all these emotions. They're all boiling to the surface and I don't know how to contain them anymore. Like, I can't distract myself anymore. And one night they all just sort of boiled over. I found myself completely broken down, tears streaming down my face. I felt like I was looking at an Instagram black and white filter. Went to wash my face, and when I looked in the mirror, I was like, I don't know who that man is anymore. Like, that was the ugliest, most fear-inducing face I had ever seen, and it was my own face, because I had let myself get to that point. And it was only in that moment that I finally realized that the only way out was through, and I needed to work through the pain. And it wasn't just the pain of the relationship. It was the fact that I'd never really grieved the sudden death of my favorite uncle, or I never really grieved my first heartbreak, because again, you're told you don't show emotions, you bury them. So when they're all just sitting in there for so long, they're going to come out one way or another. And for guys, they usually come out in the form of addiction, abuse, violence, self-harm. I mean, the statistics are only just exploding in that category. Why? Because for so long, we've been conditioned to think that we either don't matter, and if we speak up, we're shot down. And so when I finally started to work through that, I picked up the phone one day and called a guy in my life who was actually more of a friend with my ex than he was with me. But there was something comforting about talking to us to a guy that felt more like a stranger than like a friend. And I didn't want to do therapy because in my mind, only crazy people went to therapy. Like, that's the idea that I was operating in. And when I picked up the phone to call him, he goes, you know, Samir, before I could really jump into anything, he goes, Samir, I'm having a hard time. So he's a beach volleyball player, and he actually just competed in Paris for Team Canada. I can't train. I've lost my income. I can't compete. I literally just changed my life over to start this journey to the Olympics, and it's already done. I don't know what to do anymore. And I just remember thinking to myself, like, holy shit, this is what vulnerability really looks like. Like, I can't judge you. Like, I can't make fun of you. And that was the first time someone had given me permission to express my insecurities, my fears, my anxiety. And we spent 3-4 hours, and he's now one of my best friends in the world, where we just talk, we check in on each other regularly. We have a WhatsApp group with two other guys where we just call it a men's group, and we just talk to each other.
Like, imagine you didn't call him.
I don't know where I would be.
It's the butterfly effect.
Could have gone down a very, very different path. I don't know what that path is, and I don't even want to know, to be honest, but it just reinforced this idea that I was looking for permission from another man, and that there was nothing. I didn't suddenly lose my masculinity. It didn't make me beta or whatever nonsense is out there, right? I don't know why we use Greek wording for this stuff anyway, but the point is it didn't take away from my masculinity. If anything, it made me stronger. This idea that we're constantly chasing of how to be that strong male presence, it only actually comes by being emotionally regulated, confident, mentally healthy, because then you're actually in control of yourself.
Well, actually, I feel like I had this conversation with you this summer, is that I've been friends with a lot of guys throughout my life, but there's only a select few that I can say have actually like opened up to me as a friend and like been vulnerable. And I can count in one hand. And like, I have a bunch of like really close guy friends around me that could talk, but they just don't think they're allowed to or they can.
Yeah.
So it's exactly speaking to kind of like what you've just been saying.
It's the way you describe it. One of the things I was going to ask you, if you were a guest on your own podcast, like what would you say? And like the story that you kind of just gave us is probably one that you would tell on your own podcast if you were a guest, right? And it's funny that you mentioned it, because even, and I said this on yours, like when you're at your darkest days, you don't care about anything else. And like Russell Peters' story is the best example. Nothing else matters. If you're not happy and if you don't like the picture of the person you see in the mirror, if you're not happy with the person when you close your eyes at night and go to bed, nothing else fucking matters. And the fact that, you know, some people are like, oh, you can't go to therapy. Like when I told people I went to therapy, like so many people were shocked. Like, I still go to therapy. And when I tell people, like, wait, what? I'm like, yeah, it's a long story. Like, I've been going for years. Like, you? I'm like, yeah. Like, well, what do you have problems about? I'm like, are you inside my head? You see this guy that's, you know, fairly handsome, has a good job, can get girls, is cool, social media, blah, blah. It's like, okay, cool. That's exterior. What about inside? What about, you know, what's going on in my head? Nobody here knows what's happening inside my head. And the problem is if you're not okay with the person inside, nothing else on the outside matters.
Yep.
It's like the idea, you could have the most beautiful person, if they're ugly on the inside, they're fucking ugly.
Yep.
It doesn't matter. Right? So it's a shame that, you know, even in 2024, we still deal with it. Like, I don't know if you posted this stat, someone did the other day, it's like 70% of men over the age of 40, single men over the age of 40, have Googled about suicide. Something like that. And I was like, that's an insane stat to read.
I saw a stat from the Mental Health Commission of Canada that said, amongst the ages 15 to 39, suicide is the second leading cause of death amongst men in Canada. Do you want to guess what the first one is? What's the first cause?
Amongst men?
Mm-hmm. 15 to 39.
Addiction.
Drug overdose.
Overdose. Accidental death.
Wow.
So if it's not an accident, we're doing it to ourselves.
Wow.
Isn't that a sobering stat? 15. Your brain hasn't even fully developed.
It gives you goosebumps. And like, it's funny because your podcast is this is what yours is. Ours is always like light bullshit. Yeah. Like, we just shoot the shit. We get to know each other and we have fun and we giggle. And then it puts things into perspective because, like, I don't want to say you're doing God's work, but, like, you're doing shit that matters. And that's what's, like, so cool about yours, whereas ours is just to have fun and to meet cool people and to learn things and just to have fun, whereas yours is actually making a difference in the world, right?
Like, yours makes a difference, too.
I believe ours does. No, I believe ours
I
does.
Think, I just think
it puts a smile on people's
faces.
There's
different ways to make a difference. Yeah. Like, exactly. When I even said, like, an outlet for me during COVID, I got really into reality TV.
Yeah.
Couldn't watch TV shows anymore. Couldn't do anything. Didn't, like... I need like an hour of just reality TV and I've stuck to it. I'm obsessed. But like that was an outlet. Our podcast can be someone's outlet like that. Right. Whereas like
escape up from reality.
You're going to his podcast and it's like you're going to learn something about yourself. If I want to go learn something about myself, I'm listening to something else, reading a certain kind of book or just doing something different. But there's just different ways.
Each outlet serves a different purpose.
Yeah.
Sometimes I want this. Like I came, it's funny. I came in here like, all right, this is going to be a chill, nice conversation. And I can't help myself.
We got deep. Yeah, we got deep.
And I can't help myself. I can't help myself because it's like part of my being now. It's like every conversation I have, it's either we're going to have a real meaningful connection or I'm just not interested in the conversation anymore. I think we were talking about this too. It's like, you know, we go to these events all the times and you meet all of these people and you're like, hey, how are you? Good to see you again. It's not a real connection. And I'm just not interested in anything less than that because I now know the value of a real connection, that anything less than that just feels fake.
Yeah.
I struggle with the views thing. So our content is hit or miss sometimes, right? It's not for everybody. And sometimes it doesn't do well in short form because it's so nuanced. It's a long form conversation. You're trying to get into a bite-sized clip. And we constantly do this back and forth of like, we posted this. Did it pop? Did it not pop? And I started doing this thing where I've started public speaking a lot more this year. I did a TED Talk. I've been doing a lot more. And I thought to myself, at the TED Talk, there was over 200 plus people in the audience. When I get 200 views on something and it takes a while to get to 1,000 or whatever the numbers end up being, that upsets me. But 200 people in a room, that's real impact.
But it's the same thing. You got to think, there every time someone's listening to your podcast and there's 200 views, there's 200 people standing in the room right now listening to the exact same thing.
Yeah.
And it's very easy to get lost in it.
It's easy to get lost because of like what social media has become.
Yeah.
You know, like I'm in the game right now. I'm so deep in it that sometimes I forget, you know, what's real and what's not real. Cause you know, I'm publishing this book and I started my pre-sale and I sold, you know, 200 copies or 250 copies and I'm really happy with that. And then I'm thinking, okay, but last month I just did 40 million views and I only sold 200 copies. I'm like, 40 million, like that's a ridiculous number versus 200. And even my publisher was like, Ricky, those are 200 people that spent their hard-earned dollars to go and buy something that you put like countless hours into and like late nights and something that you've built from like passion and love and all these other things. Whereas 40 million, okay, that's great and that's exciting, but it's just some people could just be scrolling and going like, these are people that literally went to look, find what you created and like went to support it and purchase it and do all that. So when you think about it like that, like 200 is still fucking a lot. Like I sold 200 bucks. I'm really happy about it. But then there's times where I'm like, hey, like, why am I not selling more? Why am I not doing this? Why am I not doing that? Because of these other numbers in my other aspect where it's like social media, okay, 40 million. I'm like, why am I not selling, you know, 10,000 bucks or something? Yeah. And it's like, it's a constant struggle. And like, that's kind of the point I was saying is that like it the struggle between reality and virtuality. Is that a word?
Anyways, virtual world?
Between the virtual world and reality is so like intertwined right now where it's like sometimes when you're, especially when it's like, take a step back and appreciate what's real. And it goes like what you said, 200 people in a room, like that's fucking sick.
Yeah. You feel the energy in that room.
You
feel
it and you see those eyes. Listen, it's like even when musicians go, they might have a song that doesn't perform well online. It might only get, I don't know, 50,000 streams or something. But then they perform in a room with 200 people singing their song back to them. I'm pretty sure they'd rather those 200 people singing back to them than a song doing 100,000 downloads or something, right?
Well, I think this comes hand in hand too. Like we say the same thing about Zoom podcast. I don't know if you've ever done a Zoom podcast.
I've been a guest on one. I refuse to do one. Like to host
you
it.
And George did some at the beginning. It was obviously COVID. And then we've done a couple here and there just because they're not locally based. But like now we won't do them. because you don't build that connection. Because like in the room, there is something about the energy and kind of building it.
Well, I always said, the point of our podcast is that our audience becomes metaphorical pals with our guests, right? We're pals. We're pals now. The audience should be pals. We should all be a big fucking happy family. If I don't feel that I became pals with the audience, with the guest, and I'm in this, how is the audience supposed to feel that?
Yeah.
You know, if I don't feel like I really got to know the guest and become friends with them, I don't expect my audience to. Then if my audience doesn't and I don't, well, what was the point of doing that? And like even a lot of those like little comments get so lost in Zoom.
No.
Or the search, oh, it cut out there. Sorry, can you say that again? It's like, fuck it, never mind.
Or you don't actually know if they're paying attention to you or checking an email on the side.
Yeah, it's different.
I've done a virtual interview with someone whose partner just kept walking into the frame, talking to them literally during the interview. And he would just like look up and respond and then come back to me. And this is being recorded and I'm like, what
do I do?
Yeah. Like, why am I here? Like,
what do you expect me to publish this?
Yeah, like it's wild. But to your point, the virtual element is just, you lose something there.
What's been the best moment of your podcast? Like if there's any one single moment that stands out in your mind right now, what's that one moment? And then Danny, over to you too for our podcast.
Start with yours. Let me idea on mine.
He does podcast.
No, because it's gonna sound very stupid.
It's subjective.
I'll give you one right now. Mike, we're going to see Michael Marchese on Friday in Toronto, okay. And he was a guest on the podcast, and we became friends with him. And I was like, I DM'd him the other day. I was like, hey, like, you know, like, I see you're in town. Like, you want to catch up? And he messaged me this morning. I saw the message when I was just like, hey man, like my bad, I'm missing this. Like, here's my number. Text me. Like, we definitely got to meet up before and after the show. I'm like, that's cool.
I think there's like two things. Like,
to me right now.
For me, I think it would have been doing my first episode here. I was also not in a good mental space myself. Got thrown into that, and I was like very nervous. Had never done one by myself, and that finishing that and some of the messages I got were really nice. And I think that was just like a memorable moment for me.
That's a really good one, Danny.
But then I also think that like, there's some episodes that me and you have done, and like there's one in particular, and I remember just like finishing it and being like, wow, that felt really good. And you even like made a comment being like, okay, yeah, that was a good episode for you. But then a cool one would be like when Penny Alexia came to say hi to me. Yeah, and like cool. She came up to me and I was like, you're an Olympian. Who am I? I also wasn't on the podcast. Like, I was like just helping him and George out.
Yeah.
So I'm like, this is a cool moment. Yeah, anyways. Those are always cool.
Yeah. They are. I had that with who did I have that with recently? It's like sometimes, you know, you have the hour with them and then they leave and you're like, you'll probably never remember me. And then they'll see you at an event or something and they come up and they say hello and you're like, whoa, cool. It's almost like you needed that validation from the outside. But it's still like, it's a nice warm feeling because it reminds you that people are genuinely nice for the most part.
For me, it's one thing I always love is when I see the guests out after and we say hi, because it's like, what the goal of this is to become pals.
Yeah,
we did.
Yeah.
You know, we had, and one of my favorite episodes still to this day is this British boy band called New Hope Club.
Mm-hmm.
they were on a media day. They were in Canada for a media tour. They just did, you know, 5 or 6 interviews that day, and they get to ours and we're always the last one of the day because we're a little small podcast. So they sit down, like, oh, you guys want a drink or something? I was like, oh, we can drink on this? I was like, yeah, what do you guys want? Like, one guy's like, oh, vodka. I'm like, sure, I got vodka. I'll have a drink with you. Fuck it. Why not? It's a Thursday night. I kid you not, this fucking kid pours a quadruple. And he's just down here. And we're drinking. And we're having the best time.
Yeah.
We didn't talk music the entire episode. And then
towards last 30 seconds.
And then toward like,
oh, yeah, why are you here?
Yeah. And then you see, like, the PR people in the back. It's like, come on. And then we're like, okay, I'm like, are you working on anything exciting? And like, the lead singer's like, yeah, we're not. Yeah. Should we tell them? And the PR guy's like, no, you're not allowed to tell them. It's like, when's this being released? We're like, in a week. He's like, fuck it. We like you. Our song's going to be the FIFA World Cup song. We're like, well, he's like, yeah, and I haven't told anybody. You guys are the first ones you're hearing about that. I'm like, that's fucking sick. I took these kids to like the Leaf game after.
Oh,
like,
nice.
We ended up going to a Leaf game. They had never been, like, just, we had the best, and we still like randomly DM each other. Like,
yeah.
It's like, that's the purpose of this, is to become pals, to become friends, and to really like connect with people. And when it happens like that literally like fills my fucking heart.
And that only happens because you were able to have an authentic conversation. And it doesn't, it's not a 5 minute at an event conversation. It's a, you're sitting together just talking about whatever, wherever the conversation goes. And then by the end of it, you're like, you're a cool person.
Well, let me ask you this. When was the last time you had an hour of someone's undivided attention? Like outside of the podcast, like where they are not focused on what to eat, what to drink, where they're going, the football game in the background, the, who's winning the Leaf game.
Texting them.
Who's texting them. When was the last time you had an hour of undivided attention? Imagine he's like, oh yeah, earlier today, no problem. Like me and my partner, we do no phones and everything.
Imagine, yeah. Can't remember the last time because nothing's popping into my mind, but I could tell you right after this taping, I'm going to have dinner with one of the men in my life that I'm really close with, and it's just going to be a, let's just talk. We're going to grab some ramen, probably next door, actually.
It's good.
It's good. Yeah. Ramanition.
Yeah, it's my favorite. Yeah. I love that place. Just fix your delivery fees, please.
But ramen doesn't slap the same when you...
I think it
you,
does.
If you get the noodles on the side, sometimes
no,
it
most places give a noodle on the side.
Yeah.
Nothing slaps Kay. Harder than getting it.
Sorry. No. Please, I have to know this because I'm...
Ramen doesn't slap the same when it gets delivered.
Oh, 100%.
You have to eat it. It's like McDonald's. Anyone who orders McDonald's does not slap the same when it gets when you eat it live right
no,
there.
No, I think it's fine.
No.
Yeah, I agree with the ramen part. You have to have it when it's just like they literally finished, they put it in a bowl, it's in front of you.
A little sprinkle of whatever they sprinkle.
100%, yeah. But what was the question?
When was the last time you sat down with someone?
So I'm going for dinner, ramenation next door, and we're just gonna chat, catch up on life. So the guy that I called during the pandemic introduced me to this guy and we just became like the best of friends. And again, it's this whole idea of, you know, I mean, girls do this all the time. You go out for like just a dinner with one of your girlfriends and you just talk. Why don't we do that? Right.
I feel like you and your friends do.
I do. I'm
like, but it's not a common thing.
It's not a common thing. I'm very like, me and my guy friends, we call to check in on each other.
Yeah.
And I'm very fortunate that I've got amazing like men in my life that understand, you know, hardships, that understand struggle, that understand, you know, mental health, that understand that, hey, friends are supposed to be there for each other, not just to get drunk and party and fuck girls. Like there's more to life than that or make money or whatever. So me and my group of friends, like we're all good. But I know a lot of people don't have what I have. And that's why I'm very grateful and very fortunate for my friends. And none of them listen to this, but I love you guys. If you do listen.
So on the topic of friends for men, I did a podcast where I was a guest. And so I'm from Lebanon and the podcast skews Middle Eastern. And the question for, you know, that was clipped was, why do Middle Eastern men struggle with their emotions to express them? Why do they, you know, hold them back? And I talked about how, you know, we're just always taught to remain silent, stoic. We don't talk about things and whatnot. In the comment section, it exploded with men basically saying, this is weak. This is, you're creating a new generation of weak men. Your women won't respect you. You can't talk to your women this way. They'll leave you, etc. You can't talk to your boys this way. They'll take advantage of you. Like very like what type of world
very
do you live in?
Tate kind
of
shit.
Yeah. Performative masculinity. And in the same comment section, women are saying it's so refreshing to hear a man talk this way. So they're not even reading each other's comments. They're just saying what they want to say. But there is one particular kid. It's like, I mean, from his photo, he looked young. Constantly just like hounding me, like this is terrible, etc. And I kept challenging him, like, why? Like, just help me understand. Tell me your perspective so we can engage in a conversation. He sends me a DM. He goes, can I ask you a question? How do you make male friends? All the men in my life, I can't be friends with. If I ever try to express the challenges of growing up in the country that he's in, he's like, I can't find a job. It's hard. I'm just trying to get through life. I can't connect with any of them. And the ones I tried with make fun of me. So here is this kid who on the outside and in the public discourse is saying all the things he thinks he's supposed to say as a man in the hopes that other men will see that and maybe he can make a friend. but really and truly what he craved was connection. And it takes us talking about, yeah, I'm going out to have dinner with one of my buddies, and no, we're not watching whatever game is on tonight. We're literally going somewhere that has no televisions. We're going to sit 3-4 feet in front of each other, and we're just going to talk. And for us to say these things consistently, where it's like, oh, maybe it is okay, maybe it is normal to have these conversations.
It's sad that it's not normal, though.
100%. I'm like, I don't...
Can I ask you guys a question? I have...
No. Podcast is over.
I have a lot of close men in my life since I was like in high school, elementary school, everything.
Yeah.
And I've been able to have these conversations with these guys, but I've never thought about the fact if they ever had them with each other. And do you think they were more comfortable because it was with me?
They were more comfortable because it was with a girl. So I was that way. I was more comfortable talking to women because I knew that women at minimum would at least be maybe a little more empathetic, and maybe they wouldn't judge me as much. They might still. I mean, if you look at the comment section of a lot of posts, you see women saying that even this conversation is weak. Mm-hmm. But in my life, I was like, all right, you know what? Maybe I'll talk to a woman and she'll give me some advice because I don't know how to talk to other guys. And so for those guys, that's probably the reason. I mean, that's not to take away from, you know, what valuable advice you probably gave them and stuff, but it's just more so comfort. And the reason they don't talk to the other guys is because they're afraid of like sounding weak, sounding stupid, saying the wrong thing. And if they were to try and it gets shut down, like if I go, you know, Ricky, I'm struggling today. And you're like, okay. And you look uncomfortable. I'm now uncomfortable. But there's also something to be said about the fact that maybe you don't even know how to receive that information because you're not used to having that conversation. So if I came to you and started sharing something deep and intimate, you're just like, I don't even know how to like respond to any of this. So I get cold and frozen and I don't know what to say.
See, it's so tough. And I don't want to say I'm fortunate that I struggled and I battled, you know, depression, because it taught me so many more things about life. But in one way, I am fortunate that I struggled with it, because someone who on the outside seems to have everything, most people wouldn't know that I struggled. And because I did, I'm more empathetic, I'm more understanding, I'm more supportive because I've been there. Like, people that haven't been there don't understand the idea of depression. Like, my dad's a, you know, an Italian who's 60 something. You know, when I told him I had depression, my dad was like, so, wait, what? Like, you know, these guys, they don't understand what it is. Oh, well, you just, can't you just like, I don't know, keep yourself busy, like go to work or something. It's like, oh yeah, it's that easy. I'll just go to work and I'm cured of my depression. Like, some people don't understand because they didn't have the tools growing up. Now we're in this like middle area where the tools, we have the tools, but some people don't utilize them. And some people don't access the tools we have. And some people are still scared to talk to their friends about it because of the idea. And because these like Andrew Tate, these Dan Bilzerian, these whatever guys that made, you know, masculinity, make masculinity masculine again, or whatever the fuck they said. To me, I don't give a fuck. Yeah. I'm so confident in who I am now. And it's taken a dark place for me to get here, that when I'm struggling or I've got something that sucks or I'm going through a tough time, I have no problem talking about it because I'm so confident. And I know that, hey, if I'm this confident and I'm going through something, I know that you got a fucking problem. You got a fucking problem. You got a fucking problem too. Whether you all talk about it or not, you guys are all battling the same shit I'm battling. Because I know nobody's life's perfect. If I'm talking about my struggles at work, I got a good job and I'm doing pretty well at it. I know you got some struggles too. I got girl problems. Well, fuck, I know I'm better looking than most. So if I got girl problems, you probably got some too. I've got fucking skin issues. I got better skin than most. If I got them, you fucking got them too. And knowing those, it's like, hey guys, maybe you don't want to talk about it, but I'm talking to you. Because you know what? Maybe you might not listen. You might not understand. I'm going to fucking vent either way. I don't give a fuck, because me venting is a way to get it off my shoulders and get it off my chest, and it makes me feel better. Some people can't, and then maybe some they see you vent and they see, oh fuck, you got problems with your skin, you got nice skin. Oh fuck, well, you know what? Hey, I actually got, what skincare do you use? Or hey, you're having problems with girls? Okay, well, like, fuck me. Actually, me and my partner are fighting a lot too. Like, what would you do in this situation? Mm-hmm. When they see other people talking about it, they think, fuck, okay, well, you know, he's gonna open up about it too. Oh fuck, I didn't know he struggled with that. Oh fuck. Let me tell him my problems now. And that's how it starts, right? And I'm, again, this is not the right word, and this might sound so bad taken out of context, but I'm very fortunate. I struggled at when I did, because I had the right tools and I had the right people in my life and I had the support I needed. and I was open enough, and God willing, my family's the fucking the best, where I went and I had no shame. I didn't think therapy was for crazy people. I was like, oh, cool. My fucking mind hurts. I got to go to the mind doctor therapy, right? Mm. Just like your teeth hurt, you go to the dentist, your bones hurt, you go to a chiropractor. And it opened my mind up to so many more things where it's like, you know what? Fuck, if you're going to judge me, and like, I know people make fun of my TikToks and my content, and I literally couldn't care less. I'm just like, yeah, make fun of it. What are you doing? Nothing. Exactly. I'm going to keep living my life. I'm going to keep doing me because this is my life. I don't give a fuck what other people think. So, it, mind you, it took a very dark place for me to get here. Sure, yeah. And that's the hardest part. And I don't wish depression upon anybody. But once you get to that mindset where it's like, hey, this is you, and everybody's got problems. Nobody's life's perfect, no matter what it seems like. The Andrew Tate, the Dan Bilzerian, trust me, they got more problems than the rest of us do too, whether they admit it or not. Everybody's got problems. Even the most masculine, powerful men, the Donald Trumps of the world and whoever, everybody's got fucking problems.
You know what's everybody's funny is...
if you disagree with that, fuck you. Don't care.
I refer to it as performative masculinity. It's a show. You're putting on a show. They're charismatic. So I was asked, why do guys like Andrew Tate appeal so much to young men? Like, what is it about these guys? Because when you listen to them talk, you're like, what is this person actually saying? Like, what is this nonsense coming out of your mouth? And a broken clock is right twice a day as well. So with enough things being said, something is bound to be right. But the rest of it is nonsense. Why are young men so impressionably attracted to an Andrew Tate? And it took me so long to finally understand how to articulate the words that for so long young men are told, be quiet, man up. Here comes along a very charismatic, well, like good physique, on an island, surrounded by beautiful women, drives amazing cars, rich for all, like from what you can tell anyway, social media savvy, comes on and says, I see you. I see you at your worst. When everyone else was telling you to be quiet and man up, I'm telling you that I see your shit. I see your pain. Come with me and I'll show you exactly how you grow out of that. Except when they grow out of that, they're basically subscribing to some notion of masculinity that's very much just like, go to the gym, still don't talk about the emotions, and unless you drive a Bugatti, make $1 million, then you've somehow failed as a man. And let's be honest about the economic times the world lives in. How many of us are making over $1 million a year driving a Bugatti, living on an island?
Well, the 0.1%ers.
Right. And even they're not happy. I did an interview in Miami with a billionaire, and he was like, it means nothing. I hit $1 million. Wasn't enough. I hit 100 million, wasn't enough. I hit 1 billion. The rest of my life didn't suddenly feel better. I still had work to do. It's all a show, but young men are so impressionable. They spend most of their time on social media and they're in an echo chamber. They see other men commenting, saying, yeah, this is the right way. And there's a longing for connection. So they go, okay, I guess this is, I'm going to follow this. They see women that they want to date in the comment section saying, yeah, this is the definition of a man, because the types of women that are in the comment, even Russell Peters said to me, he's like, the types of women that most of these men are trying to go after are not the type of women you actually want to be with. When you actually get to know them, and this is the same, this is true for women when they're going after certain types of men. The types that you're seeing online are not the ones you actually want to build a life with. It's all performative.
Yeah, honestly, I can't agree with you more. It's sad that, again, these young men are subscribed to this notion that they have to be fit and rich to get the girl, or they have to be drive a nice car and this and that. It's like, none of it matters. And there's a, I'm going to butcher this exact quote, but it's like, if you're out with your boys and someone gives you $1 million, are you happier? They said, yeah. It's like, okay, well, now you're on a date and someone gives you $1 million, are you happier? Yeah, of course. Someone says, oh, you got $1 million raise at your work, are you happier? Yeah. Your mother, your father, the person you love the most in this world is about to die. We give you $1 million, are you happier? No, not at all. I just want that person to live. That's all I want. I want more time with that person. money doesn't really make that difference at all at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. And everybody struggles with it. We all want to make more money so we can all travel more and do this more and do that more. And it's like, fuck, it's so tough. And I'm part of it too. I struggle with it too. But when there's more important things in your life than that, and when you see those things slowly start to slip away, and for like me, one of the most important things in my life is time. Time is the one thing that you can't buy. Time.
Absolutely.
Health, debatable. You can kind of buy it depending on, you know, what you eat, what you do, and whatever. But time, you can't. We all got the same amount of time. And it's so tough because when you lose that time, you're just like, fuck, like I can't buy more of this. But back to the idea with like young men especially, it's like, it's sad that they can't talk about it. It's sad that they don't open up. It's sad that they don't, you know, have more role models to look up to. And maybe in 20 years this will be different. And I do believe that, you know, maybe even in 10 years it'll be different, because look where how far we've come from 20 years ago.
Absolutely.
You see all the you know, manly men, you know, 20 years ago coming out now talking about it. So I don't have the stats right now, but like there's so many male movie stars from the 80s and 90s that have come out and talk about how like they suffer from addiction, mental health problem, depression, anxiety, all these other things. And
yep.
It's just sad that it's taken this long for it to come. Yeah.
And I've got two comments on that. I interviewed Phil Heath, who's a 7-time Mr. Olympia. So like that's the epitome of the bodybuilding. And I get on a call with him. This was a virtual interview. It wasn't for the podcast, unfortunately, but half an hour I spent with him, and he talked about how none of his 7-time wins would have happened if it wasn't for the fact that he was emotionally vulnerable and mentally sound, because he had to accept that he was going to face challenges along the way. He couldn't do it by himself. He needed to rely on people in his life. And when things weren't going well, he needed to accept that he wasn't feeling great and he had to work through those. So here's when we talk about, like, we often associate the gym as the only thing, this will solve all your problems. You work out, I work out, we get it. Going to the gym for a guy is a big deal, but it's not the be all and end all. And yes, you can actually work out too much. That could actually be a problem. But here's the epitome of the masculine form. 7-time Mr. Olympia going, none of that matters unless you're emotionally and mentally regulated. And then when we talked about the, you know, hopefully in the next decade or two, we'll see a change in this mentality. You're familiar with St. Mike's College here in Toronto?
Mm-hmm.
So every year for their grade 12s have a retreat before they go to university. And they reached out and said, Samir, for this year, for the keynote, we want you to come and deliver a talk on modern masculinity.
And you know, I went to St. Mike's, right?
Oh, no way.
I was part of those retreats.
Okay.
I was the first like lead counselor for the grade 12 retreat. For the grade and the grade 10 winter retreat.
Oh, very cool.
So like Alive Outdoors is the one that runs it. Do they still run it?
I don't know. It was in like hosted at Waterloo University.
Oh, okay.
So they had been asked, the student council who was sort of like running that was asked, what topic do you guys want to talk about? What do you want your keynote to be about? And they paused and they said, we want to talk about men's mental health because we're going into university. We don't know how to support ourselves, let alone our friends. We don't even know how to be there for them. And I just thought to myself how inspiring it is on days where I'm thinking to myself, I'm up against a brick wall of performative masculinity and negative masculinity, to see the next generation of young men so openly saying, yeah, we want to talk about this. And yeah, it's okay. Is inspiring, because I didn't even know the words mental health existed when I was in grade 12.
A different side of that. My sister's actually in grade 12 and she came home from school yesterday and even during the day was texting us, absolutely livid because of what some of the guys were saying in her class about women, about how we should be living life, about how we're useless, we're worthless. And they just had this like very toxic old school male masculinity, and they're following whether it's politicians or social media stars that are kind of going throughout, and just everything that they're saying, it's just like repeating, regurgitating. And all the girls were really upset. And my sister's like very opinionated, and she sat there and she was just like, I'm just going to be quiet. I'm not going to start. And they're in grade 12 going into like these next big chapters. We texted her, we're like, calm down. Like, it's like no need to fight over this right now, but like, just wait till he gets to the real world. Like, there's going to be a massive wake up call for him. So it's like nice to see that like there is some people like obviously adapting to this kind of like new being able to be vulnerable and everything, but there still is a lot of kids out there that are following people online that are kind of like still sticking them to this old school like mentality that they aren't able to overcome kind of like even now.
Exactly. And that's why I sincerely hope that with the type of guests I bring on the podcast, maybe there's a music artist in there somewhere, an actor, an athlete somewhere in there that they look up to. They hear them talk about this and they go, oh, okay. If they're talking about it and I just listen to their music all day, maybe it's cool for me to have this conversation.
I think, I could be wrong, but DeRozan just came out with a book.
He did, yeah.
And he talks about his mental health in it.
Yeah.
I just saw it in the news.
A lot of the people who come out with books, Wilder Vow, the guy from that 70s show, I think he talked about it too.
So many of them are openly talking about it.
The problem is it happens like 20 years later.
It's a little too, it takes a while,
kind of like what you're saying, if you don't have this conversation now, the next generation can't hear it. If you're going to just have this conversation 10 years ago, then you're going to stop. It has to be continuous. There's always growth towards everything.
I think one of the biggest things is it's easy to, not easy. Sorry. It's never easy to open up and talk about your struggles. I shouldn't say that. It is easier in a sense that once you've overcome that battle and once you're on the other side of it, I think it's important to talk about while you're in it. Like it's okay to be like, hey, I'm not fucking okay today. I'm having a fucking shit day. And I did it on this podcast once. I bailed on an episode and I texted her. I was like, yo, I'm not fucking okay. I'm not coming in. If you want, we'll cancel it. I can't do it. I'm not in the mental space to do this episode. I'm not okay. I'm not doing it. So you either do it alone, step up and take care of this. And, you know, I'm so happy and she did because she fucking killed it. Or we'll cancel because I'm not doing this. I can't. I'm not there. And again, I'm different. I'm very open with my friends. Like I have no problem telling people about my struggles or when I'm having a shit day, I'll vent. I'm such an open book. But again, there are people that are the complete opposite of me that don't come up with an excuse to bail on something. Meanwhile, they're going through some of the darkest days of their lives. Like, hey, man, like, are you okay? Like, yeah, are you really okay? Yeah. Because I haven't seen you in 3 months and we see each other every single day. Like, is everything okay in your life? Yeah, I'm sure. It's like, well, then come out. Let me see your fucking face. Come out of hiding. Let me see you just to make sure you're okay. But it's important that people talk about it while they're in it, because I think that's the time where the most amount of difference is had or made.
Well, to your earlier point, DeRozan talked about it when it was happening to him. And I remember that was the first time I had ever heard a professional athlete talk about it. Just recently, I think it was last week, I had the former executive director of the NBA Players Association on the podcast. She had flown in from New York. And she was in charge of the NBA's PA when they were negotiating their current collective agreement, where they focus really heavily on supporting players in their transition out of the game, because that's when they experience the most amount of mental stress. Like, I'm no longer a basketball player. Who am I? I just spent the last 30 plus years defining myself this way. But she talked about how so many of the athletes are secretly having these conversations, and not every single one of them has to have it out in the open. But the fact that they're having more of these conversations highlights that there's a shift in the mentality around it, that they're not afraid that saying, hey, you know, I'm not feeling okay mentally is going to hurt their contract status, in the same way that if they sprain their ankle, it's not going to hurt their contract status. And she talked about how, I think there was a story where CJ McCollum walked into the dressing room and just said they were talking about something, and he just goes, yeah, you know, I'm just going to therapy and then I'm going to probably go pick up my kids. And then some of the younger players on the team looked at him like, what? And he's like, hey, I'm just going to go see my therapist and I'm going to go pick up my kids. And it was like that normalization of like, it's not a big deal. It's not what you think it is.
I was talking to a friend that they were like, well, what are you doing? Like we haven't seen each other in a while. Like, oh, what are you doing Thursday? I was like I got pickleball and then I'm going to therapy. They're like, oh, like going to therapy? I was like, yeah. I'm like, oh, cool. It's just like, it's part, like, to me, it's like, oh, I got a podcast Wednesday, Thursday, I got pickleball and therapy. Like, I have absolutely no problem talking about it. I think, look, therapy should be normalized. And I've told so many of my friends, and I've said this on the podcast too, I've referred my therapist to so many people that she won't take any more of my friends because she says she's just like too involved in my network now. But I do believe that everybody should see a therapist at least twice a year, just as a mental health checkup.
Be proactive about it.
We clean our teeth twice a year. Every 6 to 8 months, we go to the dentist. Even if nothing's wrong,
yep,
you still go because why? Why not? It's paid for, right? Your work pays for it 95% of the time. We go and we get our teeth clean because that's what we're supposed to do. That's what's recommended by dentists. Why don't we go do the same for our brain, for our mind?
Why do we wait until something has gotten so bad that only then do we go and seek the
help?
But
then even when things are getting so bad, there are so many people that still won't go.
Yeah.
Because, you know what? I can fight this. We're not talking about a fucking cold here that you can sleep for a couple days and battle it on your own. Like, without the proper... And again, I therapy is amazing because they don't actually fix any of your problems directly. They ask you the questions that make you think about things differently that help you solve your own problems.
Reframing
they give you
it.
The tools that you need to solve your own problems.
Yeah.
Whereas people are like, oh, well, I went. My problems are still there. It's like, well, at least now you have the tools to battle them.
Yeah.
At least now you have the tools to fix them. At least you're not going to a fucking sword fight with a spoon here. Like, you've got something in your tool belt or whatever. I don't know. But yeah, I always said I wish people did it. I know we're nearing that part, but I got a couple of things I actually really want to ask you. What's one piece of advice you would give to your younger self?
It's okay not to be okay. I needed to hear that a lot because there were so many, I can think of so many instances where I just wanted to put a fist through the wall. I just needed to like let out all that emotions and I didn't. And I got angry when I felt anything other than happy or angry because those were the only allowed emotions. Again, not because my dad forced anything on me. Like, he didn't have the toolbox either. It was just, I just thought that was how I was supposed to show up. So it's okay not to be okay.
It's a really good one. Danny, what would your piece of advice
be? I've already said this, be confident.
Oh yeah, be confident.
Yeah. How would you be confident?
I don't know, trust myself more, I guess. And more things that I was doing.
Hmm.
I think I had all like, my insecurities were eating up on like different aspects of my life. And I think if I just went into situations, stopped worrying about what other people were thinking or doing or the other people around me, things would have been a lot easier.
Mm.
Do you think you've changed much now?
Yeah, I think I've actually, like, I'm like definitely working on it and I have been working on it. And from then, like if you saw me 10 years ago till now, like there's still work to be done, but there's ups and downs through it all.
Do you think you've listened to your own advice?
Today, yeah. Man, I watch, if I come across a TikTok video of like something sad, I start to tear up. I'm like fully into my emotions at this point and I don't even care. My fiance will be sitting there and looking at me like, what's wrong? And I'll just be like, honestly, I just came across this video and now I'm just in my feels. And then like, if I see a video of a puppy or something, cause I have a little puppy and then just, it like gets me, or the thought of the fact that I'm going to outlive my puppy just breaks my heart every time I freaking think about it. But it's just, she hasn't left, right? She's like, I've not suddenly lost my masculinity because I felt an emotion. Like, it's okay.
War, military people coming home from service.
Oh my God. That. Every single time.
And you know it's coming. It's the same song. I know
it was a great song attached to it, too.
You want to know the one that gets me even more? Kids ringing the cancer bell.
Oh, my God. Anything with kids just
kids
fucking breaks my heart.
Ringing that bell. You know the song? Rise up. Sometimes I'm like, I know what I'm watching. I know what's about to happen. I can't swipe away. It's like, I need to see this kid ring the bell. And like, the more pain you see in the kid, the more I fucking cry. Anyways, before we wrap up, we've got a couple months left of the year. What's the rest of the year look like for you? You just wrapped up a whole bunch of TIFF events.
Yeah, wrapped up a bunch of TIFF stuff, which kicked my ass, but it was a lot of fun. Got to interview some amazing people. I'm doing a lot of traveling. I'm in Iceland next week. Then I'm in Vegas twice in November. Might be in Austin. Might be in Cyprus. Like, there's just all sorts of travel happening. And then in November, I'm doing a talk. So a family foundation in Western Canada reached out and said they specialize in gender-based violence. And they spend a lot of time, resources, efforts to support women who are victims of gender-based violence. And like, we can't keep up with the demand. Like, there's just, it's growing. And maybe we need to reframe how we look at this. And instead of just spending the money to support the women, which they should still, and that's what they're doing, how do we actually try to tackle the problem at its root? And so they're bringing me in to basically deliver a talk to their grantees, the people who receive the funding from the foundation, on the current form of modern masculinity and how the current iteration of it trains young men to grow up to become aggressive men. Because I'm a very big believer that it's easier to teach young men than it is to heal broken men. And so if you can teach young men to regulate their emotions, they won't lash out physically. They won't lash out emotionally, verbally, right? Because now they've got these outlets that they've worked through all these years that when push comes to shove, something happens and it triggers them, they don't suddenly feel the need to, like, they can't control themselves.
You don't need a breaking point to be able to feel and go, like, be vulnerable.
Yeah.
So if you could teach young men, like, that's what, like generationally, like, that's been the thing. Like, you have that breaking point, then you're able to kind of move forward and find those tools to move you. But like, if you can teach them at a younger age, so they grow through it and they don't actually have to go through that step.
Yeah. I mean, when I was younger, if someone said something to me, I was ready to fight. Why is it so hard to believe that men who haven't dealt with their emotions all these years are not still that 15-year-old boy who's just quick to fight if someone triggers them the wrong way? Same concept. But I've now done the work. You can sit here and say anything you want on this planet to me, and I promise you, you won't get an emotion out of me, because I'm like, I'm confident in myself. I'm comfortable. I've worked through things. I'm not going to be triggered by something someone says to me. So I'm really looking forward to. And I'm looking forward to some downtime. It's been a hard year just in terms of work, like a lot happening. And I haven't really taken a vacation. And I'm not necessarily going somewhere for those. All the trips I mentioned are work related. So I'm hoping that for Christmas, I can just detach for, you know, a week or two. Because I think I need that reset before I go into the new year.
Turn off your computer. Stop checking your emails.
Fuck. I can already imagine, like, just today doing 3 interviews. I haven't checked my inbox properly. And I just know I'm like, I'm screwed. When I finally sit down, and I'm going to make sure not to check it before I go have dinner. Because then when my buddy's sitting across from me,
that's all you're thinking about.
That's all I'm thinking about. So I'm not checking it before then.
This was a great conversation. I appreciate you.
Thank you for having me.
No, thank you for being a great guest. And then, like, obviously I knew you were going to be good because, like, you're a great host. So I would assume you'd be a great guest, but really thank you.
I didn't think this conversation was going to go in this direction, to be honest. I thought it was going to be a bit more lighthearted. Which I'm not saying like it was super like deep, but like it was a nice conversation to have.
No, this was, I appreciate this conversation.
No, I'm glad we can have it. And hopefully anyone that listens to this one will, you know,
talk to their friends.
Yeah.
On a deeper level. If people want to find out more about you, your podcast, everything you're doing, where can they go? How can they find you?
Very simply, Instagram. That's like my online business card at this point. It's just my full name, at Samir Mourani, SamirMourani. And for the podcast, it's called Gents Talk, Gents Talk. Spotify, Apple, YouTube,
Air Canada.
yeah, that's where you can find
my
stuff.
You know, when people are podcasters or like entertainment related, when they actually spell out their names. Like,
yeah.
That's the cue, always. People be like, yeah, my name's like, I don't know, Ricky Liordi. It's like, you know how many different ways?
Yeah, how many E's are in there? There's no E's.
It's like, Liordi, is there a T or a D at the end of the letter?
No, but is there like, sometimes you're like, I don't know, whatever. I know what you mean.
Anyways, thank you again.
Thank you.
And guys, if you made it to the end of this, we appreciate you. Give Samir a follow, give Danny a follow, give myself a follow, and we will see you guys next week.
Bye.
Cheers.